Thank you very much, Martin. It's a great pleasure clearly being here. Now, just following on what Chris mentioned before about the translation, and I think it's a very important concept in many ways. So in the past couple of days, we have heard actually a number of very interesting presentations. We have discussed the science that is that underpin a relationship between diet, specific nutrients, physical activity, obesity, and and cancer etiology. And what do we do with what we know? Obviously, many of us are mainly interested in the science, and this is absolutely fundamental that we protect the area of research that is focused on discovering. It would be a great error to at any time think we know enough and we should not waste any more time in doing research and we should just jump on public health. My view is that research is just a work in progress all the time. But clearly, we should be able to combine research on causes, mechanism, with a regular translation of this knowledge into indication of what could be done in terms of primary or secondary prevention. And this is what, in a nutshell, we can address with the concept of preventability. Which is the first step in one of the first steps actually in translating knowledge on causes and mechanisms into public action. We need to know how important is a risk factor. A risk factor can be very important because maybe the major or the only cause of a particular disease, or can be very important because it's not a very strong risk factor for a given disease, but is very widespread. So for any combination of what I would call a relative risk and prevalence, we need to know what is the weight of a particular risk factor. And in nutrition and cancer, I would like to pay tribute, it's almost 30 years after the publication, to the report by Richard Doll and Richard Pito on causes of cancer. That looked at all possible causes. This was commissioned by United States authorities, which is often forgotten or misquoted. And the question was, what are the causes of cancer in United States, not all around the world? And one of the major conclusions was that, you know, with tobacco and many other risk factors that you would expect, Doll and Pito came up with this absolutely astonishing estimate that 35% of cancer could be attributed to diet with a very large confidence interval. And at that time was a huge shock. I was working those days I was at Harvard, and you know, there was a huge reaction by those working on environmental carcinogenesis by saying, this is absolutely unacceptable, these people must have been paid by industry, this is to hide the role of environmental carcinogenesis and to, you know, mislead people. But anyway, that was their estimate, and this 35%, they did not include alcohol, that was considered separate, it was about 3, 4, or 5% in the American population. And at that time, there was absolutely no idea, no acceptance that obesity could have any impact on cancer risk. A few years later, the National Academy of Sciences of the United States published a second report. We used to call it the Green Book in the 80s, late 80s, because we were all going around in the nutrition and cancer field with this Green Book in our hands that was like the Bible. Was the first collection of data on diet and cancer, and was actually after the Green Book that the American Institute for Cancer Research was funded and was to take over from the Green Book into specific research on that in cancer. And then the 1997 report. And interestingly, 16 years later, we ended up with the 1997 report with an estimate of somewhere around 30 to 40%. Clearly, you can find plenty of people nowadays, and also clearly in the past, who would strongly disagree on these estimates. And this is why, in the next 20 minutes, with your patience, I will go through on how we ended up with new estimates based on the 2007 report. So the occasion was clearly the policy report that was designed as a companion to the 2007 report to indicate how scientific evidence can be translated into public health and action. Why new estimates? Well, I just said that time moves on, knowledge improves substantially. In the previous reports, physical activity and body fatness were not considered as convincingly linked to cancer risk. And we clearly have interest in comparing countries. The Dolan-Pito report was on United States. And the diet, obviously, and the lifestyle patterns have substantially changed over the past 20, 30 years. Who produced the estimates that I'm going to present? That was a very nice, let's say, and stimulating teamwork. There was a team of researchers. We had the most pleasant part of the job was basically to go through all the evidence that had been accumulated and the data and think about. We helped a lot. We benefited from support from the Cochrane collaboration from a methodological point of view. And I would not hesitate to say that most of the work was actually done by Rachel Thompson and Jota Mitro, who did a lot of the actual estimate. What do you need to estimate the proportion of a given disease that is due to a particular risk factor? So this is in the United States, this is AP101. Basically, you need three ingredients. You need to know the relative risk. You need to know the prevalence of the exposure. So what's the proportion of people drinking wine? You need to know the incidence rates of that particular cancer in that particular population. So you need to know the relative risk for drinking. So 1 liter of wine per day is 7 for esophageal cancer, that there is 30% of people consuming, for example, a liter of wine per day, and what is the incidence of esophageal cancer. Now, this is what you need. In reality, you rarely have what you need. This is always a problem when you translate from a kind of ideal world to the reality. But we are not doing too badly, let's say, for cancer risk. Clearly, we have the relative risk produced by the 2007 report. For diet, well, this is a little bit more tricky because when you go from a specific population investigated in a particular study to a country, you do a big jump. Basically, you go to a few thousands of subjects to millions. And what we have and what generally is available are the national surveys, nutritional surveys, household budgetary surveys, food consumption survey, health and nutrition surveys. They all have problems. They all have limitations, either a representativeness or a specificity of the food definition and so on and so on. But anyway, this is what is available and what we had to work with. And for cancer incidence, we are doing quite well, obviously, thanks to the widespread network of cancer population-based cancer registries, to the 50 years almost of work of the International Agency for Research on Cancer in improving the quality of cancer registry data. Now, as I said already twice, the Dolan Pito estimates were based on the United States. The National Academy of Science were based largely on North America. The most of the previous estimates were largely focused on Western countries. But as WCRF has a worldwide remit in terms of translation, we really wanted to look at different countries. Why we need to look at different countries? This is, I apologize for the extreme simplicity of the next two slides, but are more for a lay public. Let's imagine that we have two countries, country A and B. In one country, everyone eats bacon every day. In the other ones, there is almost no bacon available on the market. And let's imagine that if everyone stopped eating bacon, you would prevent some bowel cancer or colorectal cancer, and there is no bacon, no prevention. Now, let's imagine another situation where you have a country A where there is a lot of breast cancer, but not much stomach cancer, like United Kingdom, for example, and that everyone would drink some wine and have a high diet rich in salt. You convince the people to stop drinking wine, salt remain the same, but you would still prevent some breast cancer. But obviously you will not do much if wine stays the same. You are in a country where, on the contrary, you are in China, let's say, in Chinese women, rural area, there is a lot of stomach cancer, but very low breast cancer. And let's make this hypothesis that you intervene and you would have obviously a different effect. So basically you want to know, you have to take into account incidence of the disease, prevalence of the exposure. At that point we thought, well, we should estimate cancer prevention for 6 billion people, and we realized that, you know, that would have probably taken a decade. And rather than trying to guess numbers for 6 billion or 7 billion people, I forgot, Chris, what is the population you cited, but we decided to try to go more deeply and to pick up four countries that would be representative of different socio-economical situations around the world. So we picked up two high-income countries, UK and USA, also for availability of data and of availability of epidemiological studies. And then we picked up a middle-income country, Brazil, and a low-income country, China, all large enough to provide reasonably stable estimates from a population point of view. As a starting point was the judgments of the panel. We picked up all the risk factors that were classified as convincing for each specific cancer. And we went to what I imagine you are now very familiar, thanks to the 2007 report, which is the Bible, is the matrix of the convincing or probable relationship. And ideally, we would have liked to use all of them. In reality, we could not use all of this information for a number of factors, which are actually six, that were excluded. So we could not include dairy foods in our estimates because there were no panel recommendations. I just remind you that the panel faced the unusual situation that for one cancer, colorectal cancer, the epidemiological evidence suggests that consumption of dairy foods reduces cancer risk, while for prostate, consumption of milk and dairies is associated with a slight increase in risk. And there was this unique tension that one possibility was to make separate recommendation for men and women. Obviously, for women, one could have recommended dairy foods to prevent colorectal cancer, and a different recommendation for men, but this was not accepted. So we ended up with no recommendation. On dietary supplements, to be very frank, because of lack of evidence on what is the actual effect of supplements, and mainly because observational study and intervention study strongly disagree. If you look at going to observational studies, generally you find that people who take whichever supplement have a reduced risk of almost anything, including road accidents. But if you go to, because they are different. Then if you go to the randomized trials, you generally find that people who are in the treatment group compared to the placebo group usually don't have much benefit from taking, in terms of cancer risk, taking supplements. Aflatoxin, I'm sorry, Chris, we couldn't make it because aflatoxin and Cantonese-style salted fish, because we were missing information in this particular population, or maybe we couldn't find the good one. Having been breastfed and breastfeeding in general, basically there is lack of good data. And finally, for abdominal obesity, insufficient data, and the same for food containing selenium. We decided that because the trials didn't show an effect of supplementation with selenium, there was no point in estimating the cancer preventive effect of increasing selenium. Now, next step, this is very tough because you have to decide what is good, what is not too bad, and what is bad. And so we had for each of the factors decide what was the target, the ideal target. For example, for processed meat, could have been no processed meat or less than once a week. And we went for less than once a week. Then you would say, what is a medium risk factor? In this case was between once a week to no more than daily. And the highest risk to consumption, for example, of processed meat daily for colorectal cancer. And then we picked up the best scientific evidence, in this case data coming from prospective core studies, and we picked up the best estimate of relative risk. So we applied a relative risk of 1.4 for consuming processed meat daily compared to less than once a week, and 1.12 for in between daily and once a week. Now, if you then pick up all these estimates, I mean, you make all these exercises we did for each single factor and for each single cancer, this is the type of table you come up. You come up with a table that says that if everybody would increase consumption of fiber above 25 grams a day, you would reduce 11% cancer, colorectal cancer in the United States. If red meat had been below, fibers was 30 grams. Red meat was below once a week, would be 5% reduction, processed meat 12%. Non-drinking alcohol at all or below a given level of 5%. More than 21 minutes a day, I don't remember why it was 21, but was more than some physical activity would prevent 15%, and if everyone had a BMI below 25, that would be another 9% prevention. And this is based on the idea of, moving everybody down or up to what is the ideal target. So if you add up each individual factor, you end up to a given number. In this particular case, it's 57%. And the question is this 57% correct? And the answer is no, it's wrong. It's wrong because by looking at one factor at a time, you would forget two fundamental concepts. One is that you cannot prevent a single cancer more than once, and the second is that there are multiple exposures. So people are exposed to A, B, C, and D, so that people are actually you know, consuming or not consuming fiber, consuming or not consuming red meat, consuming or not consuming processed meat. So in fact, we all live in a multiple exposure environment, and we all have multiple, let's say, we are exposed to multiple factors, and by there is this concept of joint exposures, and by modifying one and the other and the other and the other, obviously, you can only prevent that I or you will not get colorectal cancer, but you cannot prevent that I will not have colorectal cancer twice. So this is basically that what we call the joint exposure analysis, and the 57% ends up to 45. And if you apply this, which is the right way of calculating attributable risk, you will never go above 100%, which is the, I would say, the kind of naive criticism that is often made of the use of the preventable number of cases or etiological fraction. The naive criticism is if you add up everything, you go to more than 100%. And the correct answer is, well, only if you don't know how to compute it, because if you know how to compute it, you take into account the joint exposure, you never go above 100%. So we did take into account the joint exposure, and this is the type of reasoning and methodology that is behind the numbers that have been published. Now, is it exact science? Is it like measuring the distance between the heart and the moon? No, it's not like the exact science. It is an approximation. It's based on existing data. It's based on existing relative risk, existing knowledge of exposure. But is the closer we can get to the measurement that is needed for public health. Now, what I'm going to show you in a few slides, and just to give the panorama, I would say, is first of all focused on 12 cancer sites, and then that have been analyzed in more detail, and then on all cancers. A specificity of the work done by the WCRF or the WCRF panel is to have estimated for the first time separately diet from obesity. So to have a better understanding of what can theoretically be achieved by improving diet composition and what could be achieved by preventing obesity. And in a nutshell, these are the results for 12 cancer sites. Just take a minute on this slide, not only because it has requested 1 year of work, but it's quite instructive. So here you have, for 12 cancers, the proportion of those cancers that could be theoretically modified if all people who are in the medium and high risk tercile or categories would move down or up to the ideal level of consumption for a different number of foods, for alcohol, I underline for alcohol, and physical activity, and obesity. So for esophagus, it's quite impressive, obviously. Alcohol plays major role there. Tobacco is not included, so probably what is not there is tobacco. But for United States and UK, somewhere around 70% of preventability is much lower in China. And generally, you will see that the gray line, which is China, is much, much, much lower than USA and UK, with the notable exception of lung, where probably, you know, obesity is not a major risk factor, and where tobacco is the dominant risk factor, and where the four countries show a very similar, let's say, characteristics in terms of preventability. So we go from about 70% for esophageal cancer, somewhere around 50-60 for mouth, pharynx, and larynx, somewhere around 30-40% for stomach and colorectum, very, very similar. China is much lower in preventability for colorectum because of much lower impact of obesity. And then you go down to liver, where in these countries where aflatoxin is not a major risk factor, where hepatitis B virus is not a major risk factor, you are down to a rather low preventability, around only 10-20%, which is a bit surprising, and possibly it's because in this analysis we have not been able to look at the interaction with hepatitis virus and clearly aflatoxin was not a major factor. Now, another way of looking at the data is to look specifically cancer by cancer, instead of looking at, you know, everything together, is to look cancer by cancer, and this is obviously available in the report, on the specific risk factors. So, for example, in USA, is quite intriguing the fact that obesity, physical inactivity, should not physical activity, there should be physical inactivity, and alcohol are somewhere similar in the proportion of cases that are caused and therefore could be prevented. So have a similar weight. Alcohol tend to be forgotten. You know, all the accent goes on obesity. But if obesity is 17%, alcohol above 2 drinks per day is 11%, which is not trivial from a public health point of view. Now, another way of looking at the data is just what we have seen for the USA, but looking simultaneously at the four countries or multiple countries in the future, if we can, will be able to do it. And for example, you see how alcohol is so important in UK, 22% of cancer could be prevented. Breast cancer could be prevented by reducing alcohol consumption, but so trivial in a way from a public health point of view in China, 1%. I know that this message on alcohol is not very popular. I know that when Valerie Beral presented the 1 million women study results on alcohol and breast cancer, again, she was not very, very, very popular, but is a reality. Nowadays, with the United Kingdom having the highest consumption, one of the highest consumption of alcohol in Europe, well above France and well above Italy, and with UK women having probably one of the highest consumption with Denmark and a few other countries for women in the world, this is quite astonishing. Basically, it says that theoretically, one breast cancer out of five in UK is related to excessive alcohol consumption. I don't want to ruin, you know, any party, but this is the reality, at least of our current knowledge. And this has to do clearly with a huge variation in exposure. Just one moment of attention to this, because this is the proportion of the population. You have heard this at the beginning of yesterday morning. Of the population above 20, with BMI above 25, so from 61% to 28%. And the change is going the wrong direction, so is that actually is going up here instead of going down there. So there are reasons of being really concerned. This is one way of summarizing. We are approaching the end of my presentation. When you bring everything together and you look at the effect of all what we have seen so far and we know so far, you know, basically we are very close to what Dolan Pito estimated published 29 years ago. We are still there. UK a little bit higher, probably because of the impact of alcohol consumption. Interestingly, Brazil and China, you know, are coming up close to the 25-30%. And now if we look at what is the specific effect of obesity, and this is the first time, I think, that is done in conjunction with diet. Obviously, there has been a number of important publications, also from IRC on obesity and cancer, but this has been an effort of separating the effect of obesity by taking into account the effect of diet. So for some cancers, it's really major. For pancreas cancer, this is in men, the five cancers with the strongest association, pancreas, esophagus, kidney, colorectum, and gallbladder, going from 10 to 30%. And for women, it's clearly endometrial cancer, followed by esophageal cancer, gallbladder, kidney, pancreas, and breast. Anecdotally, obviously, this was the only one cancer that was known to be associated with diet in the 70s already, but was considered to be quite an exception because already in the 70s was known that in the adipose tissue, androstenedione is transformed in estrone, and therefore that androgens are transformed in estrogens by aromatase enzymes. So that was known 30 years ago. But everything else has been accrued in the past, basically in the past decade. And esophageal cancer has been said many times. This applies to adenocarcinoma, basically, not to the squamous cell carcinoma. And this is, if we bring together all possible cancer, we basically are at around 20 to 10% range going from United States to China, specifically due to obesity, with very similar figures in men and women. So to conclude, all what we have put together, what has been put together by the panel, by this huge collective effort, indicates that the proportion of cancer that are attributable and potentially preventable by changes in diet, nutritional status, physical activity, and body fatness is substantial. And what is actually new is that there is a substantial proportion of cancers that are probably specifically attributable to obesity and that might be prevented just by reducing obesity without theoretically interfering on the dietary pattern, just balancing energy intake and energy expenditure, at least based on current evidence, and that the overall effect is somewhere between 25 and 30%, probably a bit stronger in high-income countries because of alcohol and obesity, and somewhat slightly lower in lower-income countries. But still, we are talking about the second most important identified cause of cancer in the population after tobacco. And at the same time, we know very well that our current knowledge is not as good as we would like. We know that our estimates are incomplete. For example, we haven't included the number of cancers in this estimate because the association that were reported in the WCRF report were somewhat around the possible, probable, and convincing, in this gray area that by which we did not include them. So it's possible that we might have overestimated some effect, but we may have underestimated other effects. And 30 years later, we are at this level of estimates that were initially suggested by Dole and Peten. I think that while we need more research, we probably have 30 years of history behind us that says we should move on in translating this knowledge into effective public health measures. Thank you.